Hello, everyone. This is Peaceful Anarchism on the Voluntary Virtues Network every Thursday from 1 to 1:30 p.m. I'm your host, Danilo Cuellar, and today we have Katy Khaos, who is a voluntarist infiltrating the public schooling system, spreading anarchy.
Oh, yeah!
So, Katy, tell us about your experiences in government schools.
All right. Well, it's definitely interesting. I love the kids, number one. That's the best part about the job. You know, their personalities are really great. They're talented at a lot of technical trades. Like, I work at a comprehensive school, so they go and get their academics there as well as their trade, like plumbing, cosmetology, landscape, auto. A whole bunch of tech fields too, so they're just so interesting and they think different too. So, but they still are forced to take these academic courses like on the same rigor as other surrounding schools, and they're still put through the conveyor belt of state tests after state tests where it, you know, the stuff that they're never going to use and they know they're never going to use gets crammed down their throat. And it's just, it's such a shame that I can't teach them practical math skills that they're going to actually use in their field. I'm forced to teach them like adding polynomials and like finding the slope of a line and triangle sum theorem and stuff that, I don't know, the more geometry stuff is good, but what they did this year is they did away with geometry because in Pennsylvania, the only thing that's on the state test is Algebra 1. So, like, literally, kids take Algebra 1 in freshman year. They take a Keystone test at the end of the year. If they fail it, they take Algebra 1 recovery or, like, remediation in 10th grade. Take the test again. If they fail, they take Algebra 1 again junior year. If they fail that, they have to do some kind of Algebra 1-related project their senior year, which... they're going to leave high school not even seeing geometry. And some kids are so much better at stuff like that. So just the academics is maddening. Stuff like that. And then what happens is they're disenchanted, right? So, like, they don't want to do the homework. They don't want to study for a test. They don't want to listen to lecture or show, you know, model an example of something that's so dry. And then, you know, they... like, with all the laws and things in place, like, they don't have the same consequences that they should. Like, you don't study for a test, you should fail. But then you got people on the phone saying, hey, so-and-so needs to retake the test or do test corrections or, you know, do this. And there's all these helicopter professionals coming in, like the IEP teacher, or which I am one of those too, the guidance counselor, the parent. And then all of a sudden, it's like they're not allowed to fail anymore. And I know it's a stupid subject that they're learning, so it's tough. It's like a catch-22. It's a stupid subject. They shouldn't have to do it. But then they're learning these bad habits by not having consequences. Yeah. True, they shouldn't have to do it in the first place. They should just be learning their trade. But then they learn all these bad habits from academics, and then that spills over into their job, into their technical class. And they just kind of get used to this is how it is. If I fail, it doesn't really matter. Someone's going to swoop in and save me anyway. And that is like a true tragedy. And they kind of associate learning with being in this awful prison-like building and sitting in a seat and asking to go to the bathroom and doing worksheets and on awful outdated methods, and they associate that with learning, and then they just hate learning. So, I mean, that's really frustrating. There's a bunch of other things too. I mean, I talked to Jeff Berwick about this. We got military recruiters in the school. Every week they're doing, you know, stuff with the gym classes. They got like a pull-up pole outside the lunches. Wow. They got flyers they're handing out, pamphlets, they're signing people up for ROTC. That's kind of frustrating. And then I don't know, just working with a bunch of other statists.
So tell me some of the conversations that you get, like, with your coworkers. Like, do you touch on some of these subjects with your coworkers? Like, what do you how do you approach them?
It's just, it's like a pile-on effect. They kind of know what I believe at this point just from following me on Facebook.
So you're friends with them a lot.
Like, I feel like anything that I say, they know that they don't believe the overall philosophy, so they all just pile on and start, like, saying these crazy comments that they know are going to, like, either instigate a fight if it didn't already start or just continue to, like, goad me within the conversation. And, like, I'm not very quick-witted. I'm not very, like, on-the-spot effective. Yeah. I'm more of, like, a sit and mull it over and then come up with a good response. So that method of interaction really, like, I don't know. I don't like it at all, but I still practice it. So, I mean, we were talking about spanking last week, and they're all like, oh, yeah, I love spanking. I got spanked, and I'm just fine. And kids got to learn respect these days. They're saying, like, all the typical things. Like, the arguments we're so tired of hearing, like, the people that are anti-spanking. But they just jumped on that. This week was voting, because with midterm elections coming up, that seems to be a popular topic. And I just kind of threw it out there that I'm not voting, and that is, like, I feel like he's heel for even just minarchists or, like, patriotic, like, constitutional libertarian types. That's their Achilles heel. That's like the, oh no, you gotta vote. So for a statist saying that, it just blows their mind. Sorry for using the F word.
No problem.
I guess you can edit that out. But, So really interesting conversations. And, of course, they always say the predictable things with that, too. Well, you know, if you don't vote, you can't complain, you know. And it's just, I'm so tired of hearing these arguments. My argument today was, like, I'm not giving up because, you know, my one friend said, are you giving up? Why don't you just write someone in? And I was just like, you know what? I'm not giving up. I'm just not giving in. I'm not going to endorse something that I fundamentally completely disagree with. And I guess I could go write in, like, Bozo the Clown or Donald Duck or something.
Some people do that. I heard of some people do that.
Which is all fine and good. But the thing is, that'll take time to go and do that. And time is such a valuable resource to me. I didn't want to spend it playing their little political game. Like, oh, let me go pull the lever or quick check the box. Or push the button. I feel like it's almost, I don't know if I want to say immoral to vote, but it is kind of the most aggressive thing that most people will do in their lifetime, because you're literally voting for someone to go extort other people with the barrel of a gun. Like, sorry to take it there, but I don't know. So it's interesting. Everyone just piles on me.
There was a recent conversation I got about voting on Facebook. There's one guy who's actually, you know, I guess he would consider himself an anarcho-capitalist, but he likes to vote. Like, I meet some people like this. They call themselves anarcho-capitalists, but they like to vote. And the reason for that is because they say, well, if my vote helps to, reject a measure that, like, is going to, you know, increase taxation, increase whatever. You know, if my vote helps to reject it, then that was a good thing, right? So therefore, voting can be good.
That's why I'm kind of, like, borderline on calling it immoral. I don't really, I'm okay with people that go out and do it, especially if it's local. Or, like, smaller, community-oriented, and especially if you're voting on issues. Like, I know Derek Brose is doing a lot of city council activism with the fluoride in Houston. So I think that's good. You kind of have to play the game with issues and in your local community if you want. I mean, I probably wouldn't. It's just still not for me. But I'm fine with people that do. And I think that they do good because, you know, no fluoride in the water, for example, is better than fluoride in the water. Or whatever the issue may be. It is a step in the right direction. So I'm glad that there's people that do stuff like that. I just don't know if it sits well in my stomach.
I mean, Derek is not voting, as far as I know. He's going there. He's voicing his opinion, right? But still, I think even if you are participating in that way, I think you're still legitimizing the institution of government, which is an immoral, violent institution, right? And that's not satisfactory in my mind. You know, we have to. And also, the other thing is, you know, you can vote. Like, voting inherently is not bad when you vote every day. You vote when you buy something. You know, you vote when you buy raw dairy or not, right? You vote when you go to a, you know, an herbalist over a doctor, right? So So that's voting every day. We vote with our dollars, right? But voting applied to the political process, completely counterproductive and violent. Definitely, I would definitely call it immoral and violent, definitely.
Yeah.
I did a whole piece on that.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah. I wrote a lot about that, and I did a video on that. Yeah, that's what it is. You know, it's like people who are not capable or not expected to make decisions in their own life. They need government to do that, but yet somehow they have the you know, the mental acumen to force other people to agree with their opinions. at the barrel of a gun, right?
Right. So. And like, you got to think about, why do they all want you to vote? Like, all the politicians, all the celebrities are saying, rock the vote. They even made, like, I don't know if you saw it, there's this video with Lil Jon and Lena Dunham, and it's done to the tune of, like, turn down for what? Only it's turn out for what? And then they have a bunch of people saying, like, why they're voting, like, what issue appeals to them.
Yeah.
And it's just such a complete propaganda piece. I almost threw up when I saw it.
And
I definitely want to do like a mock the vote mocking video of that.
Nice.
So, but it has to be done right because, and it's like a really fancy produced video too. So with a lot of big name celebrities, and it's like, oh my God.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous. It's like Puff Daddy back in the day, vote or die.
So,
they're all just such little sheeple. Yeah,
I mean when I was younger, I voted. The last time I voted was 2008 for Obama.
Oh.
And the reason for that, I mean, like, I wasn't really political at all. Like, when I was younger, I didn't really care about politics or the economy at all.
Mm-hmm.
But I grew up in a democratic family. You know, all my grandparents, my aunts, uncles, you know, my mother, fiercely democratic. And so, vote Democrat, you know. It's like, who else would you vote for? So that's why I voted, you know. I didn't think much of it until,
and then they give you a little sticker when you walk out. And
do they? I don't even remember. I don't know. But I just then later, and you know, as you read more, you learn more, and you understand what government is, and you just get repulsed and disgusted by the whole charade.
Right.
That you just don't want to participate anymore, you know?
You get so disenchanted. But you know what else I thought of? That's kind of, I don't know what the word is, but I get these little things in the mail, these little flyers, and they're basically slam pieces on our current governor.
Yeah.
And they're endorsing the guy that's running against him, Tom Wolf. It's Tom Wolf and Corbett in the state of PA. And I don't give a shit about either of them. But but it says on the back of this endorsement for Wolf and this hit piece on Corbett, sponsored by PSEA, which is the union I'm a part of. And I thought that my union dues didn't go to endorsing political campaigns or figures, but it says right on the flyer, you know, sponsored by. So where are they getting money to do that? And they have a lot. And they're nice flyers, and they have nice magazines where it's like Wolf all throughout it.
Yes.
So I don't know. Actually, that's one thing I kind of want your opinion on. I haven't really given this much thought yet.
Yeah.
Like in a stateless society, I wonder how something like unions, like, would there be a need for unions? Would they have a place? I think right now they're so awfully corrupt just because of the state and the corruption and the lobbying and the endorsing and the money getting thrown around. I think that's a big problem, but I wonder if there's a place for them in the stateless society, if they would even be like functional.
Yeah.
I didn't give it much thought. I actually just thought about it, and you're really smart, so I would love to know what you think.
Actually, that's one topic I got into a big argument with one of my family members.
Okay.
And she really went off because, you know, unions, we need them because it protects, you know, employees, you know, without them, they're going to be taken advantage of by their employer. It's going to be child labor, going to come back, you know, child abuse in the workplace, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And but the other thing is, like, I remember talking to one of my previous patients, and he was part of this, you know, Intendments, that factory make those dessert things.
Yeah.
Well, they're like closing down one of their factories. And so he was saying that, I said, so are they going to close down? He's like, well, my union's going to tell me. And then we started talking about unions with him, and I said, so what do the union do? You know, what do they do? He's like, they collect dues, and then they, I guess they make sure everything is, they're treating us okay. And I said, can you not pay your union dues if you wanted to? He's like, I don't think so. And I said, so it's forced.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess it is forced.
Yeah, I don't like that.
You know, and that's the other thing. Like, if it's so good and they're protecting us, okay, then I would want to
pay voluntarily.
Yeah, I'd want to voluntarily participate, right? Why do I have to be forced to pay for it, right? On top of everything else. And like what you just said, yeah, they most often have political connections. So, and talking about a stateless society, you know, with unions, I don't really think something like that would be necessary at all, because, you know, when you remove taxation, regulations, you know, all these mandates that just restrict and inhibit businesses from flourishing, then it's going to be, I think it would just be beautiful that,
yeah,
you wouldn't need something like unions to come up. You know, I think unions is just, actually, you know what I was reading in the book? Have you read Henry Hazlitt, Economics in One Lesson?
Yes.
Okay.
I love that.
So he talked about unions a little bit in there. I don't know if you remember, but he was basically saying how what they do is they enact certain laws that that make inefficiency more pronounced.
And incentivized almost.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, they incentivize all the wrong things, it seems like.
Yeah. Like he was saying examples like, you know, if it's a union for plumbers, you know, they have a pipe and only a certain type of plumber can do this, not any type of plumber. And it's like a simple thing too. It's like anybody can do this. No, it has to be this type of.
Yeah.
You know. So go ahead.
Oh no, I was just gonna say, and plus I just thought about, like, if teachers are working for a school, let's say, or employees for any other type of business, if the boss or whoever's, you know, kind of managing, in charge or whatever, if they're treating their employees awful and horribly, I feel like word's gonna get out about that employer or that school, and then no one's gonna want to work for them. Like, if the employees aren't happy, you can use that ostracism to kind of get the word out there, hey, you know, my boss did this to me today, and show the proof, and then that's awful publicity.
Yeah,
I feel like that will kind of regulate itself. They wouldn't really
need
unions, like the workers wouldn't need unions to protect themselves, because there's such a thing as reputation.
Of course.
But actually, I love that book. Are you familiar with Amanda Billyrock?
Oh yeah, I love her work. She does excellent.
Yeah, so do I. I really miss it, actually. I don't know where she went to, but she played such a huge part in my learning of all these things. And her animated series,
yep,
the little whiteboard
Henry
Hazlitt, that's awesome. And they're so easily shareable.
Yeah.
Someone that's new to Austrian economics, you could just pass them around.
Yeah,
it's great.
I had an idea to do something like that with my videos too, like some graphic animation, cartoon, you know, doodle animation, something like that.
And they were always like 2 minutes. Like, that's perfect.
Yeah, I know.
2 minutes, and they're like, okay, I have time for this.
Yeah, exactly.
And like 8 minutes, they're like, oh no, I'll watch this later or never.
Exactly. You have to, you know, because time is scarce, right? So you have to do the quick ones first, and then you save the other ones for later. And you know, and I do podcasts like half hour or longer, and I'm like that. I know that reaches only a small amount of people that only would be patient enough to listen to, you know, videos of that length. But yeah, she was excellent. I love her.
Definitely. And you know what? Voluntary Virtues. I wish I could listen to more in the car, because that's when I do a lot of my podcasts. Listening and audiobook, anything you can download, basically, so you're not using the data, because then that, you know, chips away. But you guys should get your stuff on iTunes if you can. I don't know if there's money available or what that entails, but because then people can just download it on their phone and listen, like, at the gym or, you know, in the car or whatever, without having to worry about using their data. Mm. Because I would love to just stream YouTube all day in my car, but
it's
going to eat away and then cost me money, so.
Yeah, I gotta look into that. Yeah, it's true. Yeah, like Tom Woods, he's on like iTunes and Stitcher. That's another way, I guess. Stitcher, I'm not familiar with that one.
Yeah.
But yeah, like another interesting thing that I get into with my my mother is she always says, but what about the companies that will pollute the air and the water and the soil? We need people to regulate those.
They're not doing a good job now, though.
Exactly. She's like, you know, these people only care about the bottom line. Mm-hmm. They don't care about, you know, preserving the environment, you know. And Derek Brose did a wonderful video a little while back about how indigenous people do a better job of taking care of their environment than governments do, right?
You know, right, because if all property was truly privately owned, there would be a big incentive to make sure the air is clean and the roads are clean or working without potholes or whatever you know, stuff like that. So I don't know. That is a tricky one, though.
Go ahead.
Me and Jason got into a really long debate last Liberty Fest in May with, like, who would protect the trees and who would own the ocean. And then it just got really weird. Like, this girl was saying, like, that trees have consciousnesses or whatever. Yeah, consciousness, which, I don't know. I mean, I care about trees, but.
So when somebody says that to me, you know, what about the environment? You know, a company trashing the environment. I think it's always healthy to put into perspective what our government is doing today, like in terms of, you know, drone strikes on weddings, you know, like nuclear detonations, invasions, occupations, genocide. You know, when you put it into perspective,
right.
A polluted stream and genocide, which one are you more afraid of?
Yeah, right.
You know?
And plus, the DOD, Department of Defense, they're one of the largest polluters in the world.
Exactly.
That's so the other thing. They're doing that too, along with killing lots of people.
Exactly. So, yeah. So you know, you always have to put these things into perspective. And like talking about the, you know, privatization of the ocean, I actually was thinking about that too, like, how would you do that? How would you do that?
It is tricky. But, like, it's kind of fun to think about these things. No one has all the answers. And we need to stop waiting for a leader to literally spoon feed us the solutions.
Yeah.
I don't know how that would work. But I know what is happening now is unjust, immoral, and aggressive, violent. There's so many other adjectives I can throw in there. I just know that.
Yeah.
What happens after that, who knows? But when... there are so many creative minds in the world, I'm sure we would figure it out and do a better job.
Of course. So. I mean, like what's his name? John Taylor Gatto, you know, he says all children are geniuses. You know, genius is as common as dirt, right? You know, if you want to have your children flourish, all you have to do is get out of their way. You know, force feeding them useless minutia to regurgitate on a test, right? That's all you don't need to do really anything, you know?
Yeah. You know what? That actually reminds me of one of my favorite memes. I'm very much big into memes. I love them. I think they are like an effective way to communicate, especially with the younger generation, because seeing my kids, they have Snapchat attention spans.
Yeah.
You gotta just, you know, and they treat their time as valuable too.
Yeah,
so I saw this one meme. It was like a little cartoon where it's a bunch of different animals all lined up in a line, like a fish in a bowl and like a bear and a monkey and a cat or all different animals. And the teacher is standing in front of them saying like, okay guys, your test is to climb this tree.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's what education is, like having all these different animals with different strengths and different needs and different talents to do one task. And if you can't do that, then you end up feeling like a failure for 12 plus years.
Yeah.
And now with college, it's even worse.
Yeah,
so,
that's a good description of government. Is one size fits all. That's what a government solution is, right? It does not entail. Say again.
Democracy, basically.
Yeah. So and you know, and talking about college, you know, that's another topic that I talk a lot about with people, because people have this obsession with pieces of paper, you know, as if that's the true significance of intelligence, you know, or wisdom is, you know, do you have this piece of paper? Whereas I think the obsession is more with the student going through the college rather than the employers, because I think most employers kind of understand that that is useless. And
yeah.
most employers would really look at your skills. And, you know, even if they do hire you and you have the pieces of paper, but you're horrible with people, why are they going to keep you? You know, if you're insulting customers, right?
Yep. That's another thing that's so frustrating. I spend a lot of time talking to my students about this as well,
mm-hmm.
because a lot of them are so resourceful and scrappy and good with their hands and have connections. And I have this one student who is in the HVAC shop, which is a very valuable field. That's never going to go away. There's always going to be a need for that. And he wants to start his own business. And he knows people in the field. He has family members. And he's good. He's a leader. I have him in class, too. And he wants to just graduate and do that and go right into the field and start, you know, gathering clients and going out and doing those things. I mean, he'd have to do an apprenticeship for a little bit, but he doesn't want to go to college, basically. And his parents have it in their head that, no, you need to go to college, you need to get a business degree, and da-da-da. And it's just, oh my God, so frustrating, because he would really thrive. You know, 4 years experience in that field would do him so much better than 4 years in a business school, college, or whatever. So,
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, perhaps. Yeah, perhaps.
Great. I'm definitely like the no college teacher, especially in my place of work. They're all so talented and skilled anyway. They don't need it. If they just, I don't know. People need to get over that, I think.
Yeah. And
employers, parents, teachers, everybody. Like, sure, there are some professions where you need it. Absolutely. Like engineering, doctors, like, you know, stuff like that, that you need a little bit more practicing, I guess. But then there's others where you just, you know how to do it, or you learn as you go, experience, get a job and practice and learn as you go. And I feel like that's so much more valuable. So with a lot of different things, just get out there and do the job.
Yeah, I think,
and then you're not in debt. And then you're not, you know, thousands and thousands of dollars in debt.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That's a major thing people overlook. You know, we have it like a given that, you know, being in debt is somehow noble. And everybody's in debt, you know, so it's okay. Everybody's in debt. We're all the same. but it's quite sad, because, you know, they all end up as economic slaves. And you know, student loan debt is the one debt that you can't get rid of with bankruptcy, right? You have to die.
Yeah.
And it's very sad. And I remember one chiropractor I worked with, he had he's 41, I think, at the time, and he was telling me that his student loan debt is like $320,000, and he says by the time he finishes paying at the payments that he's making at the time, he gets minimum payments, he'll be finished when he's 80, and he will have paid $500,000.
That is so depressing.
and that's assuming that there's not a wealth transfer or a hyperinflationary economic collapse that completely destroys the currency, right?
Yeah. Right. You gotta think of that.
and that's also actually another thing I was thinking about. So if the currency is destroyed, what happens to all the people in debt? Is that debt going to be transferred?
I assume
so, because I don't think that banks will just give mass forgiveness for everyone who's in debt.
Yeah.
You know, I can't see that happen. I don't see banks as being the merciful, you know.
Yeah, true. Although I did see an article online the other day, student loan forgiveness is becoming a possibility.
I did see that too.
I don't know what the requirements are, but I fear that that's another taking away consequence for young people. It sucks that you're in that much debt. There's no way college should cost that much by any means, but then when you just poof, snap away the debt, that's, you made a bad decision, especially if you decided to go into women's studies or something. That's not really or art history, they're very interesting, but you know, realistically, not the best choice. And then your student loan just gets forgiven. It's like you're taking away that natural consequence, even though it's an awful natural.
Yeah, so we're talking about, you know, student loan forgiveness. Yeah, I did see that. And basically what that signifies to me, like you said, it's called moral hazard, where, the person does not feel the consequences of a bad decision. And so what happens, which is the same kind of basic understanding or basic kind of reasoning behind bailouts and subsidies.
That
a failing company who has made bad choices and deserves to go bankrupt as a result of those choices gets bailed out by taxpayer money, right, which is stolen, and and then they continue business, and what happens? So they're basically rewarded for failing, you know, and so that encourages more reckless behavior, more, and you know, in the case of the banks, more gambling with you know, with the public's money deposits and you know, and the derivatives market and crap like that. So yeah.
But like, all profits are privatized, though. We can't forget about that. All the risks socialized on us. You know, they have no liability, no accountability. But when they make their money, they're gonna get it in their pockets. So it's just so awful, the whole system.
Yeah. So you went to college for 4 years.
I did, 4.5, yeah.
Uh-huh. So did you...
College is just awful. Like I said before, I'm like the type of person that like needs to like, I'm kind of introverted, actually, believe it or not.
What?
I need to like
sit and think about it. No.
And like just kind of mull it over and get my thoughts together. But like, all college was for an education major is, all right, get with your group, all this group projects, and like, and presentations and stuff like that. Just a bunch of busy work. And I don't know. I hated it because I work better by myself and I kind of like need to be alone with my thoughts. But when you're working in a group, everybody's talking and it's like, well, wait, you guys are saying good things, but like, you know, I don't want to just say stupid stuff. So I need to kind of think about it and work on my own. So yeah. I don't know. Just college for an ed major is a nightmare. It's really easy, like, academically, but it's just annoying, especially if you don't really like working in groups every single time.
So. Yeah. I did about 5.5 years of acupuncture, oriental, you know, herbal medicine, massage therapy, Eastern nutrition.
Yeah.
And I loved it. You know, I just it was not difficult for me because I loved it.
Yeah.
You know, but I was very lucky because my parents paid fully for that, so I have no debt whatsoever.
Yeah.
But still, you know, it's like people think of college as if it's frozen in time, you know, as if when they went to college is the same now as it is when they went to college.
Yeah.
You know, whereas you have to realize reality, things change. You know, we have the internet now, we have smartphones, we have Skype, we have so many things that are different that completely transforms the landscape. So,
yeah, and there's so much like filler classes too. You go 2.5 years just learning stupid shit, like literally like those filler common classes that you need to take to fulfill your requirements, but like you're never going to use, and they're really just fluff. Yeah. They're really just to keep you there for the years and pay the money. You'll never use it. Like, once college got good for me was towards the end when I was doing my student teaching. If I could have just done that right off the bat, and maybe even for a little longer, that would be so much more efficient. But colleges aren't built like that.
Efficiency. No. Yeah. Colleges are basically, you know, they're basically like, you know, it's a complex, like, you know, military industrial complex. Yeah, the college industrial complex. You know, it's so dependent on federal loans for their tuition. You know, nobody can afford those tuitions at all, right? Yeah. Most of them need federal loans. They require it. And so, you know, imagine if you have guaranteed income, you know, regardless of if the person can pay or if the person is intellectually adequate to understand the information, right? What are you going to do to your tuitions? You're going to, like, push them way up, you know? There's no competition, basically. They have no limit, you know? So I think I remember reading that from the 80s, you know, the prices of food and gas, you know, basic commodities has risen like something like 2-3%, right? And similarly, healthcare prices, similar, something like that, 3-4%. But tuition has risen like 10 times.
Yeah. And like the colleges, they have to like kind of make it seem like they need this money or they need to spend it on something, right? So what's happening now is I'm hearing about colleges with pools on campus with swim-up bars. They're knocking down old, perfectly good dorm buildings, high-rises to build brand new ones with the suites and the jacuzzis and the bathtub. Like, ridiculous things. And no one is really saying, like, wait, this is supposed to be just like a college where you go to learn, not go and like sit by the swim-up bar and like stuff like that. They're just spending money on the most ridiculous things, colleges these days.
And so what that's essentially doing is just whatever, like, you know, whatever the Federal Reserve does is blow bubbles, right, in every sector of the economy. So there is a massive college bubble that stimulating unnatural growth in building new buildings or hiring, you know, excessive, you know, staff members that are not needed, or, you know, just expanding. And so eventually, you know, when this bubble bursts, you know, it's just going to be a massive deflation.
Yep.
Where, you know, things are going to come back to parity where they should be. And that's going to be very, I'm looking forward to that, actually, because, you know.
Speed up. Get it done.
Yeah.
And then we got to make sure we have the alternative solutions in place, or at least starting to come up. You know what I mean? Like, once everything falls apart, we could be the ones that rush in and be like, well, look at this. Look at these people. They're doing it really well. That's our opportunity right there.
Oh yeah, yeah. One argument I give when I talk to people about colleges, and they're like, "Well, I need college. They need the piece of paper." I say, "Do you know that many of the curriculum of the Ivy League colleges,
they have it online for free,
are available for free?" Yeah, I was fascinated when I found that out, and
yeah,
I mean, Wikipedia, YouTube, you know, Google in general. Like, what can you not learn through those avenues for free? You know, it's just mind-boggling what people can do, you know, at the keyboard just by typing in the search box. It's just so sad that people feel like they have to spend thousands of dollars for an old guy to read from a textbook.
Yeah.
And force them,
the internet, you know? I mean, it's absolutely revolutionary. Even just like learning how to do stuff around the house. If I don't know how to do something, just type it in YouTube. There's about, you know, 2,000 how-to videos on that topic.
Even
just with the hands-on stuff, watch a quick video, try it out, see if it works.
Yeah.
Great.
So what kinds of things do you use YouTube for? Like how-to? Like, what have you done?
I don't even know. Like, how to put a door back on the hinge. How to paint without tape. How to, I don't, it's like stupid stuff. Mostly Jason's is it.
Nice. So you're saying you...
Tell the feminist.
So you're saying you search for him, right?
Yes.
You do the search and he does the reading, right?
He usually knows how to do it already, but I'm like, wait, what's going on here? And I watch it. But no, I mean, and stuff like, I don't even know, just philosophical things. Like, I was like, do you ever listen to Carlos Morales' show, Truth Over Comfort? Amazing. School Sucks podcast, one of my faves. But sometimes they talk about things that make me feel so dumb. And it goes right over my head.
Like what?
So they'll use vocabulary like, I don't even know, consequentialism. And I'll have to go look up exactly what that means, or just a whole lot of other new things. Like, they're on another level. And I'm trying to get there. But they have some good chats. I just can't always follow very easily.
Yeah, I know what you mean with the consequentialism and the deontology. You've seen that word, right? Like, that's another...
The what?
Deontology, D-O-N-T-O-L-O-G-Y.
Yeah, that's
like
a
that.
New one, too.
Like, I mean, I was asking one guy what's the difference between that, and he gave me some you know, the reason, but it's not really important to me. Like, I understand the concept. I don't need to learn... apply a new word. And he's like, I call myself a consequentialist deontologist. I mean, I don't...
Yeah.
I'm just a basic anarchist. That's it.
Yeah.
I keep it simple. You know, anarchy is a difficult enough concept for most people, so I'm like, I'll stick to that.
Right. You don't want to scare people away with your big fancy words.
Yeah. So, I mean, I learn about all this stuff. I'm reading all the time. But,
yeah.
But, you know, yeah, so.
Yeah.
What are you going to say?
Oh, no, that's, I was just laughing. You know what else I've looked at on YouTube? Logical fallacies. I'm getting really good at identifying them because they're flying all over social media.
Oh, yeah.
And especially when I'm instigating a little bit more and people throw their arguments at him, I'm like, ooh, what did he just do there? I know that's not right. And then there's a couple YouTube channels that give really good, like, in-depth explanations of all of them. So.
All right, you know, let me give an example. I was talking to my grandfather just last night, and we were talking about how, like, people work and they're not making a lot of money now. You know, there's a lot of poor people and all that kind of stuff. And he was basically saying about how people work hard or they don't work hard enough, or they don't work in the right, you know, area, something like that, or they're not learning the right things. And I was basically saying that I think people always work hard. Like, you know, let's say the Mexicans today work really hard, right? Then you have the factory workers in the 1950s. They worked really hard too. I don't think you can say the Mexicans today work harder than the factory workers in the 1950s. We all work hard all the time. So if that's true, if we all work equally hard, why is it that people are becoming progressively more and more dependent on government handouts and welfare, right? And you know, and the poverty level is rising. Why is that? If people working hard all the time, and I asked him that, and he said, it's because libertarians refuse to understand the importance of government, something like that.
Oh my God!
So basically, he completely ignored my question. So I guess that would be considered like a. That would be like an ad hominem or a straw man, something like that. Just attacking my character.
Or straw man, something. Yeah.
Something like that. But,
crazy.
But I mean, and I said, you know, and please answer the question. Like, and also another great concept I like to tell people is that, especially when they talk about minimum wage, they think minimum wage is the problem. Minimum wage is not high enough, you know? And so I say, you know, go back to 1964, when silver was still part of the money,
right?
Do you know this? You know, minimum wage was $1.25.
But their money got them farther, and it actually had more value.
Exactly, $1.25. But the difference is there was silver in the quarters, right? 90% silver. So today, if you were to go to buy a silver quarter, it costs you approximately $5.
Mm-hmm.
$5 2014 to buy one silver quarter.
That's a lot of inflation going on.
So, So just think back. And I tell this to my patients all the time. This is something that anybody can understand, right? Yeah. $5 today, 25 silver quarter. And then they make 5 silver quarters in 1964. Now, calculate that, okay? Yeah. 5 times 5. They're making $25 an hour, $2014 in 1964. They're like, what?
Are you serious? Yeah. It blows their mind.
Yeah. And that's fascinating because, you know, then you think about it, if you live for decades, right, you know, since the 1930s, right, and you saved in precious metals like in gold and silver, your wealth basically compounded massively. You know, of course, if you saved in fiat money or dollars or, you know, Federal Reserve notes, you lost incredible amounts of wealth.
Yep, but so, if you started back in the day, oh yeah, you have tremendous tangible wealth right now.
Yeah.
So,
did you study at all, like read any books on the monetary system, like precious metals? Because that's something that's what got me into all this stuff.
No. Do you have any recommendations?
Oh yeah, big time. I started with The Creature from Jekyll Island, Edward Griffin. That got me going. And then Mike Maloney's Rich Dad's Guide to Investing in Precious Metals. Excellent. It sounds like a boring title, but very excellent, well-read book. And then there's another one. It's like They Own You by Means of a Toxic Currency.
Wow.
And that was fascinating, too. And I tell people that's another fascinating thing. You know, if I want to start talking about these topics, the monetary system is an excellent starting point because everybody uses money, right? We all have to use money, but nobody really understands money. Nobody,
right.
You know,
yeah.
Or very few people, I'll say, you know. And so what I do is I take a dollar bill and I say, okay, I deconstruct all of the words on the dollar bill. That is fascinating.
Yeah.
And that's what I learned from that book, They Own You by Means of a Toxic Currency. Fascinating book. I highly recommend it. So, you know, you start off with the title. It says Federal Reserve Note. You know, this is a Federal Reserve Note. This is not a dollar. It says U.S. dollar, but that's a misnomer, right? A dollar before 1913 was 1/20th of an ounce of gold, right? That was the significance of dollar.
Yeah.
It was a receipt.
Right.
It was a receipt on gold.
Yep.
You know?
Yep.
And so what happened, you know? So, and then, you know, Federal Reserve. Then I go, Federal Reserve. It's not federal. It has no reserves. And then what does note mean? It's a promissory note, an IOU or a contract, right? It's a it's a symbol of debt, you know? And then, so I go through the whole thing.
And I'm trying to think. Oh, and the Fed I read. That was pretty good. That was not probably as in-depth as those books that you mentioned, but that was good by Ron Paul. And the
yeah,
Fed.
Cool.
So,
let me ask you that. How did you, like, your evolution to voluntarism? Like, how did that happen?
Well, actually, it started with, I found Glenn Beck on TV a couple years ago, like back in 2009, 2008-ish. So that started, like, I made the transition, like, conservative, whatever, was listening to him. And then I kind of idled there for a little bit. And then I started getting, like, mad about all the things that the Republicans were doing. And I found Ron Paul and a lot of other internet people, like Amanda Billy Rock, Julie Borowski.
Yeah.
Libertarian girl. I found her 3 years ago. I loved her. And just things like that, I was very much into Ron Paul, and then I idled there, too. It's so funny how you just get in the groove, and you just kind of stop thinking for a couple months, and you just kind of idle, or at least I did. I got busy with life, and then I guess I found, like, Adam Kokesh, Billy Rock, Stefan Molyneux, and I started watching them just on the internet, and it just went up from there, because then I'd hear about books, I'd hear about other people making videos or podcasts or whatever. And it just shot right up. So.
And we're still learning now, right?
Yeah.
Always. You know, it's like, like one thing that I wanted to get into is I want to learn more about history, you know, because so many of the knowledge of history is from our government schools, you know, what we were taught there, right?
So. I think Tom Woods does a lot with that, with his Liberty Classroom.
Yeah.
I know he makes courses for Ron Paul's homeschooling curriculum, and then he does stuff for his own. I think he does focus a lot on history.
Yeah.
So that's really interesting. Also, Bad Quaker, Ben Stone, he has a podcast. I think back, like, maybe a year or two ago, he was making a lot of history podcasts focusing on, like, the wars, things like that. So they're really interesting, and he is a good storyteller, so you just kind of get sucked into it, and it's just very engaging. So
he doesn't have a YouTube channel though, right? I checked.
He really should.
I know. I just checked his website. It's just podcasts, right, on his website, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
And then he does put them on iTunes too, but
okay.
Kind of slowed down. He co-hosts the Freedom Fiends. So I think he's doing more of that than his own show. But
I see.
He has a lot of podcasts from 2013, 2012.
Yeah. Good. So. Yeah. And you know, I was very much influenced by Murray Rothbard's book. A couple of his stuff, Anatomy of the State, What Has Government Done to Our Money, The Case for the 100% Gold Dollar. And then I bought a bunch of his other books. I'm still have yet to read them.
Yeah.
I have so many books on my list.
I think a lot of his books are on audiobook format too, and I'm a big fan of audiobooks.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah. I think most of them are.
I like audiobooks, but then at the same time, I definitely love to read. That's the thing with me. I love physical books. An obsession with having the physical.
You're not a Kindle person?
No way. Definitely not. I have no Kindle. I have no, I don't know what, there's another one, Nook, I think it's called, right?
Yeah.
and it's kind of annoying because, like, Carlos Morales, he put out his recent book, Legally Kidnapped. Yeah, and actually you should check it out quick because he's offering it for free on Kindle for, like, I don't know until when, but I saw it either yesterday or the day before for a few days.
Okay.
So check that out.
And
I tried to contact him to ask him, like, can I order this? Because I want a real book. I don't have a Kindle, and I want to read it.
Yeah.
So I always loved the physical, you know. That's just me.
Do you have like a big library in your basement or anything?
Oh, massive, massive. I just hoard and hoard books, you know. That's the thing. I think, you know, growing up with me, that's what really inspired me to want to learn new things, is having books around.
Yeah.
And you just
I always love books. It's just now I wish I had the time to like sit down and read. But I remember reading a bunch of like really philosophical things like back in middle school. Like I don't know if you've heard of Zen and the Art of Motorcycles. I love that book. I read it in middle school and I was obsessed with that. I think I might have read it even twice or three times.
Yeah.
And just things like that. I'm a big fan of Malcolm Gladwell. I think he does excellent work. He writes like The Blink and Tipping Point and, you know, David and Goliath type books, usually with a white cover if you go to Barnes & Noble or whatever. Yeah, he writes good stuff. And there's a good amount of research in his books, too, and it's always really interesting.
So you read fiction or mainly nonfiction?
Mainly nonfiction, yeah. fiction, yeah. Now I know this is like a kid's book, but I am a big fan of Hunger Games. The themes in that are very much in sync.
Yeah, definitely.
So, I really like to see that, especially for young minds. So that was probably the last piece of fiction I read, which is really sad. So,
yeah, I find that... that nonfiction is so much more fascinating and shocking than anything that somebody can conjure up in their imagination. So, like, why would I even go to the the unreal, the fantasy world when the real life is so much more interesting?
Yeah. Yep.
So, like, the last fiction book I read was The Life of Pi. Have you read that one? You heard about
that?
No,
I haven't read that one, but
yeah. So I read it because I think I got it for my birthday by my grandfather. And of course, you know, when you get something from your grandfather, you have to read it, right? So,
yeah.
So I read it, and I didn't know it was fiction. That's the thing. That's the other thing why I willingly read it. I'm like, wow, this, you know, I thought it was nonfiction, and it was fascinating. I loved the book, you know, about it. You know, I don't know if you know the story, the Indian kid from India, and his family,
like a tiger, right, or something.
Yeah, his family owns a zoo, and then sort of they're transporting all the animals over the ocean, and there's a big storm, and he ultimately it's just alone him. On a lifeboat with an adult male Bengal tiger, and there were other animals, but the tiger ate all the animals, and so yeah, it's just his story about surviving with the tiger, and that was fascinating. It's a really cool book, and I was actually on my way to rereading it, and until somebody told me, you know, that's fiction. And then I'm like, no, that's not fiction. And then I went online and I saw that it won the fiction award. I'm like, oh man. And like that's it, done. I guess I'm pretty I have no compassion for fiction, right? I don't know. I was like, I don't want to wait, you know, time is a limited commodity, right? So if I'm going to spend time reading something, I want it to be a good learning experience, you know.
Yes.
That's just me. Like, are you the same way?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so what are you reading now? Interesting books.
Actually, Bitcoin, the anonymous Bitcoin book by Christoph Atlas. He is a local Philly activist. He's very nice, very informative, very passionate, and he wrote this ebook. And you can buy it at anonymous Bitcoin book, I think. .com. So it's really good. I'm about halfway through that. I don't get a lot of chances to read, but when I do, like, during in-services, just take my iPad and
nice.
Flip through the pages there. But, yes, that one's really good and really useful, especially if you want to start using Bitcoin in a more undercover way without really having your identity attached. I'm trying to learn a lot about that. That is a really fascinating topic to me, like how to get Bitcoin kind of like off the grid and use paper wallets and cold storage so that you don't get hacked. I'm still kind of scared of that. I know it's silly, but
I don't know any of those terms. What do you mean paper wallets or
like something that's not on a hot wallet like Coinbase or blockchain. There's I saw a really good actually video on it, bitaddress.org, and it just generates addresses and then you print it out and, or, you know, save it to your flash drive, and have people send Bitcoin there, and then it's like off the matrix, like off the internet. Yeah. So I don't know.
Cool.
It's interesting. I still gotta learn more about it, but I definitely don't want my identity connected.
Yeah.
I don't want my money to be stolen.
Of course.
Like right now, I'm just using Coinbase, and I have a tiny amount.
Yeah.
In there. So.
So did you converted some of your money to Bitcoin, or how'd you get?
Yeah, I have just not even a whole lot. I got like, have you ever heard of Change Tip? It's a really cool thing.
Yeah.
On it. Yeah. Well, so someone tipped me on.
What is it?
It's like you go on social media and you leave whoever you want to tip like a moniker, like, hey, I'm gonna get you a beer, cheers, and like the word beer is attached to a Bitcoin amount,
okay,
or dollar amount or whatever. Uh-huh. But it's in Bitcoin, and then they tag you, and then the Change Tip people say, hey, you know, so and so sent you a tip of this amount, and they give it in US dollars, but it's really like in Bitcoin. Click here to retrieve it. And it like you click and they give you a wallet and everything, and cool. It's really cool. And then you attach your YouTube name to it, so then if someone tips you again using Change Tip, it goes right to that wallet. It's really cool. I like it. And then Coinbase, I bought a t-shirt from another affiliate activist, and he sent me the change in Bitcoin.
Cool.
So that's what I have in there. And I've just been using that tiny amount to learn how to use online or whatever.
Yeah. Cool.
I haven't really put a whole lot in it because I don't want to attach my bank account to it.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a wallet on blockchain.info, but yeah. I'm spreading myself out, you know, with silver, mostly silver, some gold, and a little bit of Bitcoin. Because my education was more so focused on precious metals, like you know, I was studying a lot of Peter Schiff and Mike Maloney with goldsilver.com, and you know, I just follow a lot of precious metals newsletters. So you know, that's great. Yeah, like precious metals has its advantages and disadvantages compared with Bitcoin. The advantage of precious metals is that it's tangible, it's real, you can hold it in your hand, right? And the disadvantage of precious metals is how easy is it to transfer that overseas, right? And it's monumentally difficult, right? You know, how many people get their cash confiscated by TSA, not to mention even gold coins or silver coins, right? And then Bitcoin, you know, you can like, you know, it doesn't really exist. You know, you don't have to, you know, put it in your wallet. You know, you go anywhere, you can access your Bitcoin, right?
Yep.
So yeah, it definitely has its advantages. And I think, I definitely think that we're drifting towards a more digital, economic system right now. And you can't avoid it. You can't, like, you know, you isolate yourself from it. Because if you do, you're just putting yourself at an enormous disadvantage.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's a great form of agorism.
Yeah.
It's the most prominent form. I wish I knew more about it.
Yeah.
I think it's great though. Anyone that's developing platforms for Bitcoin, I would, you know, love to donate or share their information. So
yeah. Cool. Yeah. All right. Well, don't want to take any more of your time. So let everybody know where they can find you and your work.
Oh yeah, definitely. You can find me on YouTube. Katy Khaos, K-A-T-Y, and then Khaos with a K, K-H-A-O-S. And for Twitter, it's just Katy_Khaos. And that's it. I don't have a Facebook. Yeah, I mean, I have a personal Facebook, but I don't really share that one. So
no website, right?
No website yet.
Oh, just, you got to get a website.
I know. I should get a blog or something.
Yeah, I mean, just for your videos, you can put on there. You know, it's a great thing. And I don't know if you expect to.
Maybe I'll do that.
Yeah, if you're gonna start doing some writing, that'd be great too. You know.
Yeah, like get a blog spot or a WordPress or something.
Yeah, something simple. You know, it's just a good way to put everything together in one place. You know, so you know you can link your Twitter, link your I guess you have a Facebook page, right? You have Katy Khaos Facebook page.
No, not yet.
Okay, well, you should do that too.
Yeah,
definitely. you know, the YouTube, the Twitter, and then you know, if you write any short articles, definitely put it in there.
Yeah.
That's awesome. All right, cool. Well,
well, it's so great to talk to you.
Thank you very much for the interview, for the opportunity, Katy. So this is Peaceful Anarchism on the Voluntary Virtues Network. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.